Let's go to him in prayer. Father, thank you for this beautiful day that you've afforded us. I was up early this morning. And Lord, as I left my home, got in my car, heading down the street, glanced up to see the beauty of your majesty, seeing the leaves turn different colors, seeing the brilliance of the beautiful sky that you provided for us, the crispness of the air, and then just your abiding spirit that just continues to whisper into our spirit, into our hearts and our lives that, oh, you are a present help. You're always there. You're so good. You've blessed us in so many ways. You've just poured out so much goodness and love and mercy in our benefit. Oh, how thankful we are because we serve the one true, mighty, everlasting, eternal God who can do all things exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think according to the power that works in us. Thank you for everyone that's coming into this place of worship today. I know we've got folks out sick in hospitals and going through trials and terrible times in their lives, but Lord, I know that you're also the God of deliverance, the God of help, the God of grace. And Lord, I know you're the God of healing. You're the God of encouragement. I know that you can meet our every need. And we're just thankful for all the great blessings that you supply. I was in the hospital early this morning with two of our precious folks, and to see improvements in them, what a blessing that was. Thank you for all that you do. And thank you for your presence that's in this room right now. I'm glad that, Lord, we are constantly in your presence. Help us to recognize, realize, and, Lord, be blessed by that. May you today minister to us. May you touch us. May you, Lord, use us. May you be glorified in this house of worship. More importantly, may you be glorified in us. Us today that, Lord, believe on you, trust in you, live for you, and just so blessed by you. Pray today that if there's any lost in this congregation today, that, Lord, you will touch their hearts and show them the need of salvation. I'm glad the condemnation is gone. I'm glad that we are alive and we're free in Christ. And I thank you that your presence is with us. May the blood of Jesus today touch hearts and lives. May you be blessed. May the devil be defeated in every life. May he have no entry point. We just today hold up the bloodstained banner. We hold the word up against today all the forces of evil, and we stand on what your word has said, because your word says in all these things we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. Thank you for the promise. Thank you for the blood. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the blessing, and bless the music, the message, and everything accomplished here today. To God be all the glory and the praise in Jesus' name. And all God's servants said, amen. Isn't it good to be in God's house today? Give the Lord a praise offering. Clap your hands and shout for joy. Oh, what a mighty God we do serve. Amen.
And time. Thank you. much bad news in the world right now. But no matter what, we have good news, and that good news has a name, and that name is Jesus Christ.
There is good news for the captive, good news for the shame. There is good news for the one who walked away. There is good news for the doubter, the one religion failed. For the good Lord has come to seek and save.
He's our rescuer. He's our
good Lord is the way, the truth, and the life. Yes, the good Lord is the way, the truth, and the life.
He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, how great the mountain. We will
to the foot of Calvary, where there is redemption for every affliction, here at the foot of Calvary. So come and be chainless.
Praise God in God's house this morning.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, there's a wonder working power. It's in the blood. Wonder-working power. It's in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood.
Sing, there's power,
power, wonder. It's in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder working power. It's in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Now,
would you be wider, much wider than stone? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood.
Oh, there's
power, power, there's wonder working power. It's in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power. It's in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power. It's in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, there is wonder-working power. It's in the precious blood of the Lamb. Oh, there's power, power, wonder-working power. It's in the blood. Precious blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power. It's in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power. It's in the precious blood of the Lamb.
One more time.
And there is power, power, wonder working power. It's in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power. It's in the precious blood of the Lamb.
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. You say I am loved when I can't feel a thing. And you say I am strong when I think I am weak. And you say I am held when I am falling short. And when I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe, oh, I believe what you say of me. Yes, I believe. The only thing that matters now is everything you think of me. You have every failure, God. You have every victory. You say I am loved when I can't feel a thing. And you say I am strong when I think I am weak. And you say I am held when I am falling short. And when I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe, oh, I believe what you say of me. Oh, I believe. The only thing that matters now is everything you think of me. And everything I am, oh God, I'm laying it at your feet. Oh, you say I am loved when I can't feel a thing. And you say I am strong when I think I am weak. And you say I am held when I am falling short. And when I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe, oh, I believe
I want to be your servant. Excuse me. Like I've never been before. I want to give to you all of me. I want to give you so much more. Battle rages with inside of me. I do those things, Lord, I don't mean to do. The will to do good is something that I just can't find. And Lord, I cry unto you. Inside there is no peace. I've never been before, and I want to give to you all of me, and I want to give you so much more. But I struggle with this sin that's inside of me. And this struggle, Lord, seems never to cease. And all my efforts seem so hopeless now. Lord, I cry unto you. Who shall deliver me? Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? There is an answer, isn't there? Oh Lord, I want to be a servant like I've never been before. I want to give to you all of me. I want to give you so much more. But Lord, sometimes I wonder who this man is inside of me. I hide things, Lord, that no one should ever see. Oh, wretched man. Oh, yes, that's what I am. Who shall deliver me? Who shall deliver me? Thank God, through Jesus Christ, my Lord, 'cause he forgives all of my sins. And I thank God, through Jesus Christ, my Lord, he cleanses me deep from within. And I thank God, through Jesus Christ, my Lord, he calls us out to repent. I thank God, through Jesus Christ, my Lord, he conforms our image
This morning, I'm in the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. We're in our continuing looking at examining what God tells us. And we've been in this a major part of the year. We've only gotten to the first part of chapter 8, but we're dissecting and examining everything because God spoke of a tremendous message to the church in Romans 8. And I believe that today He wants the Christians to understand what they have in Christ in our relationship with Him. Yeah, we still wrestle with the fact of sin and all the other issues that people struggle with in this world. But listen, it's not God's intention that we live in bondage. It's God's position that we live in freedom. And unfortunately, the church has not grasped that, understood that, or lives on that. And what we're trying to do is march you through that so you can grasp, understand, and get a good spiritual knowledge of what God's trying to show you here in these portions of Scripture. No longer condemned. Guilt's a powerful emotion today, whether it's consciously or subconsciously today. Most people struggle today with something they have done in their past. Maybe you are going through and have been going through a wrestling match with your past, what you've faced, what you've gone through, what you used to be, and all the other things. I'm surely glad that the Bible tells us in Paul writing to the church at Corinth says, you know, that what we used to be is not what we are today. Therefore, if any man, woman, boy, girl be in Christ, they're a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. But see, we haven't grasped that. We keep grabbing back for the past. We keep looking in the rearview mirror. We keep living in the past. Or where we were, how bad we were, and we wind up giving the devil more glory than we're giving God in the transformation and the redemption that He's worked in our lives. And we're trying to guide you today that you don't have to live in the past. The past is in the past. Learn from it, but go forward. Stop going back to where you were, what you used to be. It won't do you any good. God's got a lot out there in front of you that He wants you to live. These secret regrets can make us feel like we are somewhat trapped in, let's call it, solitary confinement. Your past will keep you from really moving forward, as I was just trying to convey that to you. But there's a way out of guilt today. I'm glad there's a way today that, man, it makes all the difference in your life. And that way is not found in a thing. It's found in a name. And that name is Jesus Christ, the King of Glory. Amen. Man, what God can do in your life, in my life, is beyond phenomenal. Beyond wondrous, beyond miraculous, because today you've got to understand what God has done. And that's exactly what Paul is trying to get the church and to understand, is what you've gotten in Christ, and that you're no longer controlled by what used to be or what you used to be or anything else, but now you can be controlled by what lives and dwells within you. And as the Word declares, greater is He that is within you than he that is within this world today. I'm glad that we have Jesus Christ on our side, our Savior, our Lord, our Master, and oh, what a mighty God He is today. The first thing that happens when someone surrenders their life to Jesus is guilt is replaced by grace. Let me say that again. Guilt is replaced by grace. Thank God you're no longer controlled by the guilt, but you don't know what I did. Is it under the blood? Let me ask you a question. Is what you did, accomplished, or whatever it was in your life that keeps tagging itself to you and hanging on to you, and it's that ball and chain that you keep dragging in through life, is it under the blood? If it's under the blood, then grace has removed it. And therefore today we don't live in guilt anymore. We live by the grace of God, because grace has delivered us from the clutches of Satan, sin, self, and everything else that was against us today. So we are no longer today have to be defining our lives by the wrong that we have done. And all of us are guilty of wrong, because the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And still, instead today, we are defined today by what Jesus has done right in our life. Everything wrong that you've done is gone if it's under the blood. And everything Jesus has done is right in your life, because it's delivered you and made you a child of God. Now, we no longer have to be governed by the guilt of what we have done. And so we are free today to live in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ for what He has done for us and what He has done in us and for what He is doing through us today. Amen. If you're able today, I'd invite you to stand for the reading of God's Word from the Scripture in Romans chapter 8. There is, boy, this first portion, this first verse is a launch pad. Have you ever been to Cape Canaveral? Have you ever seen them shoot up one of those awesome rockets that they shoot up to go to wherever it's going? Cynthia and I lived there 2 years. We lived first when we moved there. We moved and I was stationed at Patrick Air Force Base. And of course, right up the road is what is called Cape Canaveral. You're familiar with that. And there they shoot up the rockets and the satellites and all these other crazy things that they do. Well, we used to would go and sit out on the beach, because I lived right on the Atlantic Ocean, was my base quarters, A1A, then there's the ocean. I could get up every day, look out my bedroom window, and see the Atlantic Ocean. What a lot of people pay a lot of money, I enjoyed for 2 years straight in having a beach home right on the beach and loving every bit of it. But boy, when I moved out, I was sick and tired of sand, and I said, thank you, I'm not a beachcomber no more. But the fact is, it was interesting, because in being there and seeing that and feeling the majesty of those rockets lifting off of those launch pads was something else. You could feel the ground shake, because we lived and you could see the Cape is exactly what it's called, Cape. It's out. It's a jettison out in the Atlantic Ocean. And we could sit on, or even sit in our house or sit in our front yard and watch the rocket going up. And it's almost like I could take a baseball in my younger days when I could pitch. Whatever. And hit one of those rockets. Well, I never tried that, because I didn't want the FBI showing up at my doorstep. But anyway, the fact is, it's a launch pad, right? And that launch pad would provide for the lift of that awesome rocket that would be launched up into space. This is exactly what Romans 8:1 is. It's the launch pad. I took all that time to tell you, it's a launch pad. It's a launch pad, for it is magnificent and majestic what God is declaring here. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending His only Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Man, that's good. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Praise God for the reading of His Word today. You may be seated. Amen. And God's Word is the great and the glorious gospel that has saved us and allowed us today to be in this place and to experience and to worship and to praise our glorious God, not condemned but made free by what Christ has done in us today. You're no longer in bondage. We're living in a world that's in bondage. We see people every day. You may even have family members, and you may be sitting in this church today, and you are in bondage. You're in the bondage of yourself. You're in the bondage of your sin. It's entwined around you. It's controlling you. It's manipulating you. It's draining you, and it's just on your mind all the time, and it seems like there's nothing you can do about it, and you are exactly right. You cannot remove your sin. You cannot eradicate your sin. You cannot blot out your sin. You cannot take the sin out of you today. And there's only one power that can do that, and that's the power that was provided through the cross and Jesus shedding his blood, that today, thank God, there is now no condemnation to us because we are in Christ. We've been liberated. We've been set free. And listen, our emancipation today, yeah, we enjoy emancipation from the standpoint that we live in the land of the free and the home of the brave. But I've got a greater emancipation because my emancipator is the Lord Jesus Christ, that through his death, his burial, and his resurrection has made a means and a way that today I can be delivered from the clutches of sin, self, and Satan, and no longer controlled by those manipulative devices, but now I'm controlled by the power of God that lives and dwells in me. Amen. So this power now has transformed me. Oh, I'm not the same as I used to be. I don't think like I used to think. I don't act like I used to act. I don't talk like I used to talk. I don't go to places I used to go to. I don't conduct myself like I used to. Amen. Because I've been set free. Power of the gospel has removed all those clutches and chains and things that held me bound. And now, thank God, I'm free. Free in Christ. Free today by the power of the cross. In the beginning of Romans, we see God, he's working for your good. And no matter what the circumstances that you face in life, he does. And as we go on through Romans 8 and we get to Romans 8, 28, I'm glad he certainly tells us that we know that all things do indeed work together for good to them that are in God, in Christ Jesus. In the beginning of Romans 8, we're reminded of the story of the gospel, found it, and that's what we've been seeing. That's just chapter by chapter. We see verse by verse in the seven chapters that we've covered. We see a transition that's happening here that's found in these first seven chapters, and we're reminded, here's the story of the gospel of what God has done for us. So Paul begins by saying, there is therefore now. There is therefore now. Paul is running today a race, and he's in places where we're no longer, and he's telling us, he's being emphatic about this, that we're no longer in those places where we used to run. We're running a different race. We're walking a different walk. We're trusting a different God. We're no longer controlled by the little god of this world. We're controlled by the God of the universe, the God of creation, the God of salvation, the God that has made it possible for every person that would come to him and receive him. This today is really what we find in Romans 8 is the crescendo of the grace of God and what he has done for us. Amen. It's the building point. We get to this, and man, it's just like the cymbals are sounding. And we were covering a game Friday night out at City Stadium, the Jug Bowl. Y'all heard of that, right? EC Glass Hilltoppers. Shut your mouth. I'm just kidding. And the Heritage Pioneers. And it was the building. It was building. But you know what I enjoyed more than the football game? I enjoyed the bands. On the other side of the field, we were in the press box on the visitor's side, and we had the Heritage Pioneers Band, which was an excellent band. They had big band competition yesterday. And then on the other side of the field was the mighty EC Glass Hilltoppers Marching Band. Yeah. And these bands would play, and man, they would get the percussions going, you know, and then a little cling clang here and a little zing jang here and a little whoop, whoop. And I mean, it was good. And I tell you, I said, Carlton, pay attention to what you're doing. I got involved in the bands playing, and his band playing, and his band playing. They're answering each other, and it's just keep building. And they're playing these songs, and they're just clashing these cymbals. And these guys are blowing the horns, and they're juking and jiving and twisting and turning all around. I mean, it's so awesome. You can't believe it. You ought to go to some of this stuff and watch these guys. They're taking the instruments and doing this, and they're ducking and moving. I tell you, it's awesome. And they keep playing these songs, and they keep building and building and building, and they get to a crescendo. Crescendo is a musical term. It's a building point. It's where the cymbals clash, the drums hit, the horns sound. It brings you to the point. Oh, I'm telling you, that's exactly what is happening here. God is bringing us to the point, the crescendo of where all it will happen. And it's happening at the cross of Jesus Christ, where he won the victory for us. Amen. He is that crescendo. So we come, and here's the theme, and I'm going to try to give it to you short and sweet this morning. That'll be a first, won't it? Here's your theme. The Father sent the Son to condemn sin, and the Holy Spirit came to set you free. Amen. Thank God. If you're thinking about it, if you're choosing to live in the past pains of your life, those days of defeat and agony and difficulty and challenge that you went through, the seasons of seemingly prevailing sin, then you're not living in the freedom of Christ. That's been purchased today and provided for us. You say, well, that, yeah, the lost people. No, you know what? Saved people live in that. Saved people live in the past. They can't get victory over nothing because they keep hanging out in the same garbage that they lived in. God delivered you and brought you out of that. You're no longer condemned. Do you understand what that means? If you're no longer condemned, it means exactly what it means. You're not condemned any longer. That thing that had you weighted down, that ball and chain that had you incarcerated, has now been set free. Well, how is that happening? Because He possesses the keys, our God. And He's the one that can liberate you and put the key in the lock and turn and set you free. And the shackles fall off and the pains removed. And you're no longer living where you used to be and what you used to be. You're now living in the freedom of Christ. And man, it's nothing but clear skies and beautiful days ahead in Christ, amen. But preacher, how about the pains of life that we go through? But I'm glad today, even in the pains of life we all encounter, God is there with us, and He will be with us for eternity, and He will always, He's already bore this stuff, carried it to the cross, won victory over it, that you and I today can stand and praise God and shout, oh, what a mighty God we serve, amen. Praise God. Don't choose to live that way. You can live in the freedom of Christ. I want you to know today, you must realize something. I'm going to bring it out here because it's evident that the Trinity is at work. The Trinity is at work. And I'm going to come back to that. I want to take you up a mountain here. And first, we've got to be at the base, and we've got to get to the crest, to get to the top, to get to the place of clear visibility. You know, when you're at the bottom of the mountain, you have limited vision, don't you? But boy, when you get on the top, you can see. It's clear. And that's where I want to take you. I want to take you from the foot of the mountain to the peak, to the point where you can see better. One, stop ignoring your problem. Too many people, they cannot get their mind off of that problem. We have a problem. We all have a problem. We all stand in a place of condemnation. We're condemned. What condemned us? Your sin. Your sin of rejecting Christ. So when you were born, you started knowing there is a God. Remember that? Oh, you acknowledge you've never been in that position. Listen, I'm going to tell you, nobody's born an atheist. I don't care what these people say. All these isms and things that people think that they were born, I was born to be. No, you were not. You were not born an atheist. You're not born gay. You were not born any of that mess. What you were born was a sinner. Amen. You chose to believe atheism. You chose to believe there is no God. You chose that. And you're making a pretty bad choice. As a matter of fact, you're making a choice that's going to doom your soul to hell by believing that, oh, there is a God. You can't tell me there's not. And if I needed any other evidence, when I left my home this morning and saw what I saw and smelled what I smelled and felt what I felt and heard what I heard, man, I cannot deny there is a God of creation, but there's also a God of salvation. Amen. When you were able to know, you saw the evidence that there was a God and the fact that He who created and that all things were made by Him and for Him, as the Scripture tells us today. But our flesh had a love for sin. Our flesh loves to sin. Our flesh loves the pleasures of sin. But how long does it last? But for a moment. We love the world. You took that belief about God and you pressed it down and you ignored it. You pushed it aside. You kicked it to the curb. You said, that's not for me. I'm not for religion. I am not either. I'm for redemption and relationship, because religion won't set you free, but Jesus will. Religion is man's way. It happened with the siblings of Cain and Abel. With the siblings of Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel. One chose religion, one chose God's way. And therefore, the one that chose religion was the one that committed the sin against his brother and slew him. Folks, I'm going to tell you, we all have a sin nature, don't we? We're not all that we think we are. We're not as good as we think we are. We're not all that, and a bag of chips and a Pepsi Cola on the side, even a Diet Pepsi for those of you who have diabetes. So, men has always traded the truth of God for a lie, because the lie becomes a more easier way, a more pleasurable way, a more world-enticed way. So man worshiped the creation, but man failed to see the Creator. That's what's happened in hearts and lives of people today. The reason that we're condemned is because we were born into the state of sinfulness. We have that Adamic nature. Sin nature today. We all stood condemned before God. You think, my man, I'm not a bad dude. Yeah, you're bad enough. You're a lot worse than you thought you were. Amen. You can be good looking, smell good, and wear a red tie like I got on this morning, but that doesn't make you good. Amen. The only thing that will change your life is the blood of the Lamb, God. And that, I thank God, is the red. Amen. I love red ties. See some red out there. No, I didn't get the purple memorandum this morning, but I got the red memorandum. Amen. Because it reminds me of the blood of Jesus. Amen. You say, yeah, but you got a black suit on. But the blood of Jesus blots out every transgression, removes every iniquity, and casts from me every sin, and redeems my soul, and makes me a child of God. Hallelujah! I'm glad I'm free in Christ today. We stood condemned before Him. The penalty of this condemnation brought a horrible thing. This is very basic this morning, but it's very needful in the life of Christians and churches. This brought death. But what mankind has done is that it's taken the problem that knows exists and thinks, I don't have a problem. Oh, yes, you do. You've got a lot bigger problem than you thought you had. Brother, it's a problem. And you know what it is a problem of? It's a problem you cannot fix. I'll show up in church, sing Amazing Grace, and everything will be all right, and I'll even shake the preacher's hand. It won't fix you. I'll steal a songbook and take it home. That still won't fix you. Now you become a thief on top of that. Well, I'm a good person. I'm doing the best I can. It won't fix you. It won't fix you. I'm going to go to the bookstore. I'm going to go to Amazon, and I'm going to order every Bible that there's available in every language, tongue, and every translation and everything. It still won't fix you. There's only one thing that will fix you, and that's Jesus and His atoning, delivering, transforming blood that sets you free. Amen. Amen. Second point. I'm going fast now. Stop trying to fix it yourself. Stop trying to fix it yourself. Sin is something you cannot fix, friend. Well, I'm going to this class, and I'm going to that class, and I'm reading this book, and I'm listening to this motivational speaker, and I'm going through this program. It won't fix you. I'm not trying to be negative. I'm just being honest with you. It's not going to fix you. Amen. You can read every book, but the problem is we're not reading the book that we need to read, and that's called the Word of God. Because in this book is the freedom that comes through Christ and the blood and the cross. This is what God designed for you that started in the Garden of Eden. In Genesis 3:15, what God said, this is the beginning of what God would provide for sinful man. A means, a way of escape. For Jesus said in John 14:6, I am that way, I am that truth, I am that life. So today, sure, you've tried to be a good person. Yeah, your neighbors think you're so good. You cut your grass, you keep your bushes trimmed, you keep your house painted, you wash your windows, you just got everything looking sparkling, you even wash and wax your car 3 times a week. You're just a good person. And you even take your family to church. Christmas, Easter, and somebody passes away. You try to keep the law. I'm going to keep the Ten Commandments. You can't do it. You can't keep any of the law. You've tried to do good, but you can't. Man, that sin just keeps sneaking in under the door of your life every time. You try to explain it away. Well, you know, in my family, in my lineage, well, you know what? No, you know what? You can't fix it. You can't fix it. You can't earn your favor with God. You can't. You can't earn favor with God. You better realize something here. James said, your life is a vapor that appears for a little while and vanishes away. You never know when the rap is going to come on your heart's door, and it's going to be death that says, I've come to take you. You don't know that, when that will occur. So the weakness of your flesh makes it where you cannot fix yourself because your flesh can't fix you. You're decaying. I didn't come into this world looking like I look today. Amen. I had golden locks when I was a baby. Curly locks all over my head. Now I'm a platinum blonde. And that didn't come out of a bottle either. Amen. Things change. A few dots here and a few lines here and a few places here and a few veins and aches here. It's amazing. I thought, boy, how am I going to get? I'm going to have to call somebody to pull me out of bed this morning. It's been a rough week last week. It's been a rough month. It's been a rough year. And I mean, it just seems like there's no break. It's just nose to the grindstone. Up early, out late, come in, dragging. Well, anyway. And you think, man, I don't know. But boy, I tell you, I woke up so refreshed this morning. God is so good. That's what the dose of the Holy Ghost will do to you. Amen. Amen. When you think you can't, He will. He'll fix you up. So listen, you got a problem. You can't keep the law because you're unable to do that. And you have no ability to save yourself. You cannot pull yourself up out of what you're in today. You can try all. You think, well, it's a new year coming here in a couple months and I'm going to turn over that new leaf and it's going to be a new year. No, it's going to be the same old stuff, just a different day. So we're standing condemned before a holy God. And because of that, you can't fix it. And because we have rebelled against the truth, and now the news is worse because of this fact today, we cannot fix ourselves. Third point, it's only four. We're halfway home. Start looking for divine help. So we can't fix our problems, but guess what? I've got great news for you. Do you like good news today? Do you like good news? Come on, y'all. Y'all get better than that. Do you like good news? Good news. Amen. God can fix it. God can do it. God can fix whatever's wrong in your life today. So why is it so important that we believe then? Remember I told you about the Trinity? Well, we're back on it here. You must believe in the Trinity because the Trinity saves your soul. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Really? Yeah, God's working in a triune fashion to save you today. So this is what we believe about the Trinity. Let me give it to you in a kind of a quick passing review here. The eternal truth that God reveals today Himself as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost. People say, well, what's the difference? They're the same, just different names. Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. Some Baptists say, well, I don't say Holy Ghost. You know that's Pentecostal. Oh, is it? When did you figure that one out? Where'd you get that from? It's Bible. It's not no religion or denomination connected to it. I'm not connected to a denomination. I'm connected today to a Savior who redeemed my soul, who purchased me, who today has done something better in my life than any religion could ever do for me. Amen. Praise God. And what's so wild about this is there's distinct personal attributes in each person in the triune God, but it's without division or nature or essence or being. They're the same. So they're distinct persons of God, but there is not a division in God. You know, you can't go to Jesus and say, well, Jesus, could you just, I need to talk to you alone. God don't need to hear this. Well, if you're talking to Jesus, you're talking to God, huh? If you today are talking to the Holy Spirit, you're talking to God because He's all three in one. Amen. So we have one God, but we believe that there are three persons of God today. No, there are not three parts to God, and there's not three forms of God today. All three are fully God, and all three are part of one God. One God. So we know that three persons of God are at work in our lives, and that's great. That means today you've got the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all working in your benefit today. Man, that is fantastic. The Bible describes each of them as having a role in your salvation. So what's those roles? First, God the Father. God is the one who plans today your salvation. He planned your salvation. If you don't believe that, go back and read what happened in the book of Genesis and all the way through the Bible. So it's God who today initiates the fact that he is providing salvation today. It's God who sent his Son. So Jesus came because God the Father sent him. So God the Son, Jesus, then accomplishes the plan that God has, and that's to redeem sinful man. He becomes the one that brings about the plan of God. God initialized it, and then Jesus accomplishes it today. So God planned it, Jesus accomplished it. So this is done by Jesus being submissive to the will of the Father. What was the will of the Father? The will of the Father was for him to go to the cross and die, not for himself, but for us. He became our sin substitute. He paid our price that we couldn't pay. Remember, you can't fix it. But he did. All through the blood, amen. Thank God. So Jesus takes on flesh and becomes what we call the God-man, as Scripture tells us today. This is what we call the incarnation. Fully God, fully man. Then we come to God. Verse 3 says, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. So Jesus was not sinful. He was 100% man, but he was 100% God. So Jesus came in the likeness, underscore that word, likeness of sinful flesh. He also became as a sacrificial offering or as a sin offering for all. Jesus died for every human being on this earth. So by being, folks that say, well, you know, I believe in predestination, election, and all this. Where'd you get that at? That's certainly not Bible. Jesus came for all. Amen. God commended his love toward us all. And while we were yet sinners, Christ died for all of us. So by being the sacrificial offering today, he accomplished the salvation for us. He completed the plan of God. And it went out completely and entirely completed of Jesus. He carried and accomplished the plan. So what did Jesus do on the cross? Jesus conquered sin, death, hell, and the grave. Amen. Thank God. All that mess has been conquered in your life. He ended the reign of sin, that it does not have to reign in your life. He defeated sin through what he did at the cross, and he won a victory over sin. I can't win the victory, but man, I don't have to because he's already won it. I'm not trying to find it. Thank God. I'm glad the victory found me and brought salvation to me. So then we see, here's the third person, the Holy Spirit. So God, the Holy Spirit, then does what? He applies. I like that word apply, don't you? Amen. He applies the salvation to our heart. Not a flesh transaction, a heart transaction. It's an inside job. Salvation is an inside job that gives evidence on the outside. Amen. So the Spirit brings conviction. The Spirit brings conversion. And thank God we can be converted today. So the Spirit of God applies the work of Christ at the cross that God initiated in his plan to redeem sinful man. So all the stuff that churches are telling you today is nothing but a bunch of rubbish. All these denominations is telling you all these different ways to God, to heaven. Folks, it's all by what God has put in his word. It's through the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And if you don't come that way, you're going the wrong way. Amen. Praise God. Verse 3, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in in, set you free in Christ Jesus. Understand, the Spirit then leads you to salvation, and the Spirit exposes you to Jesus Christ and the forgiveness that He offers. For the Spirit shows you your sin, and He shows you Jesus, and He shows you a better way. He shows you the one that can fix your life. Amen. Once you're saved, the Spirit of God then works a work in you that is called sanctification, because sanctification follows salvation. But you got to want that sanctification. Had I wanted, it means today you want to be like Christ. I talked this morning about abiding in Christ, and that we need to abide in Him. And the only way you can abide in Him is to be sanctified by Him. That you release your life to Him, that He's guiding your life. You got to take your hands off of you. Because you know what you keep doing? You keep wrecking the car. You keep running the thing in the ditch. You keep messing up. I'm so tired of messing up. Well, why don't you start letting Jesus today change your life, and you can stop messing up so much. Let Him fix you. It's only He can do. Fourth point, and somebody said, amen. That's mighty weak, so I won't preach another hour. Amen. Start enjoying your freedom in Christ. And that's where most Christians are missing the boat. Oh, we do 1, 2, and 3, but we're not enjoying. Well, you just know, preacher, things are so hard, and life is so tough, and I have so much on me, and I don't sleep at night, and I just don't know what to do, and I just chew my fingernails, and all I don't do is chew on hamburgers, and all I want to do is watch as the world turns, and I just don't have a life, and just life is so hard, so tough, and I just don't know what to do. Oh, shut up. Why aren't you enjoying life in Christ? Amen. Yeah, but you know the Democrats and the Republicans, this is the biggest mess. And who knows what Pelosi's going to do next? And what is Trump going to do this time? What is he going to get on and tweet about and sing about and squawk about? And what are the Republicans going to do? What are the Democrats going to do? And what are all the bobbing heads that sit on the news media keep telling you the same old garbage pail mess that's going on, and none of it makes any sense? You know what? I don't have time for that. Just like that woman, that commercial came out some time ago, some years ago. She said, I ain't got no time for that. I don't have no time for that either. The only thing I got time for is God. Amen. And man, I found out I needed Him today. And I found out today that the great act of God to save you is one about bringing great joy to your life. You can live in joy unspeakable and full of glory. Amen. You know, you can still smile. Yeah. You can still smile because Jesus put something in your heart to smile about. You can still today realize, and now you can be ruled today by the joy of the freedom that came with Christ Jesus. If you've been set free, doesn't that bring freedom? Come on, y'all. And doesn't freedom bring joy to your life? Sure it does. For the joy of the Lord, as Nehemiah said, the joy of the Lord is your what? It's your strength today. And the reason the joy of the Lord is your strength today is because there is there now for no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. Amen. Sin will defeat you, but Jesus sets you free. Defeat does not have to reign in your life. Christ has removed the condemnation. Today He has removed the curse. And today Christ has removed the conquered life today. And Jesus has come to set you free. And you need to start living. If you're in Christ, you need to start living in the joy of the salvation that He has birthed within you today. Stop listening to the bobbing heads and the talking people on the television sets and the radio and everybody that you work around and the bleakness and all the gloom and doom that we hear. Hallelujah, man. Thank God you realize one day I'm going to be walking on a street of gold. And if you're in Christ, you are too. You realize this is the worst it will ever become in your life. If you're free in Christ, you realize it's not going to get any worse. It's just going to get better. And one day, the King of glory, the King of kings, and the Lord of lords is going to split the sky and rapture out His church, and we're going to be in the presence of God forevermore, and we're going to have something today to be joyful about. I'm not waiting till I get there to have the joy. The joy is already there. Amen. Praise God. Jump up and praise God. I dare you. I dare you. Jump up and give Him some glory for the great God that He is. Amen. Sit back down, I gotta finish. Christ has removed the condemnation, and Christ has set you free. It's time Christians start living today with the joy of the freedom that Christ has provided. Whatever you're struggling with today, Whatever guilt's on your mind, you've got to remember this fact. God no longer declares you condemned before Him. The moment you place your faith in Christ, a miraculous change happened or occurred. Have you been today, have you been declared not guilty through the faith and the blood of Christ? Are you saved? Are you saved? Because that's the only thing that's going to bring freedom to your life. Are you struggling with your past? You just don't know what I did. Jesus knows what you did. And He's willing to forgive you, even if people don't. Amen. Are you struggling with the fact today that you're not saved? You don't have to. You can leave here today redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. How's that? Realize you're a sinner. You sin. And you can't fix it. Realize that Jesus did fix it by coming and dying on the cross for you. And by receiving what He did, He will fix and change your life forever. How can you turn that down? I deal with people every day. And some say, well, maybe not now, maybe later. Oh, really? So are you going to have a later? Do you know for a surety that you're going to be here tomorrow? You don't know that. I don't either. That's why Paul said now is accepted time. Behold, today is the day of salvation. In closing, a simple plea for you today, in whatever the capacity that you find yourself in, today, listen, you can come to Jesus, for in Christ there's victory and no condemnation. Would you bow your heads for a moment? We're going to have a video, a song here in a moment, Christ alone. But before we do that, I just want to ask you a very personal question. You and I are just sitting there talking with each other at the table, and I looked at you and I said, listen, are you saved? Do you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you're going to heaven? You know that you've been redeemed, and you look at me and you answer me with sincerity and honesty, and you say, no, preacher, I don't. I don't have that assurance because I've never given my heart to Jesus. Oh, I've heard about Him, and I acknowledge and I believe there is a God. I even believe there's a Trinity, a triune God. But I've never really meant business and asked Him to come into my life and save me. Why don't you do it right now? Because that's what you need to do. Would you pray with me this prayer and mean it with the honesty of your heart? Dear God in heaven, I need You. I need Your forgiveness. I need Your redemption. I need Your salvation. Forgive me of my sin of rejecting You. Forgive me of my sin of pushing You aside. Come into my heart. Come into my life. Forgive me. Redeem me. Make me Your child. Thank You, Lord. I believe that I just received You as my Savior, and that You just made me a child of the King. You just wrote my name in heaven and given me salvation. Thank You, Lord. If you prayed that prayer a moment ago and you said, Carlton, I meant that with my heart. I really meant that. And I asked Jesus to come into my heart and my life. I'm not going to embarrass You in any fashion, form, or shape. I'm going to keep you in my prayer life because I want to pray for you, and I want you today to live in the power of Christ that now lives within you. I just want you to do one thing. Would you just lift your hand up right now and say, preacher, I prayed that prayer. I meant that prayer. I asked Jesus in my heart and my life. I know I'm redeemed. Would you just lift your hand up right now? Right now. Anyone? Anyone? Now, Christian, how are you living your life? Are you struggling? Are you living in the past? Come on, let's stand up. You don't have to any longer. Jesus says, come on. Come unto Me, all you that labor, heavy laden. I'll give you rest. We'll have this invitation song, and I invite you right now. Father, touch our hearts and draw us to altars of prayer. Help people to leave here today free and blessed and living in the joy of the Lord. Pour out Your grace. Because it's all, as this song says, it is in Christ alone. Would you come? Come on.